now invite my next two speakers up to the stage, which is Richard Dobbs, director at McKinsey, and also Hans Timmer, the director of the Europe and Central Asia Division at the World Bank. Yeah. Domestic situation from the Prime Minister and the Minister, but what about the rest of the world? What are the key global and regional trends? Where does Kazakhstan fit in those? What are the challenges? What are the opportunities? And what needs to be done, firstly by maybe the government here, but also by business and potentially investors? What are the actions for them? Maybe Richard, if we start off with you. So, I mean, McKinsey obviously works all around the world, and you see these trends playing out in a lot of different geographies. Which trends do you see as being most critical for Kazakhstan?
We're in the midst of a major global transition, and I think it's easy for us to forget the scale of what's going on. One way of thinking about this is to put it in a historic context. If we go back 2,000 years and work out where the global economic center of gravity of the world was. So you imagine you do a physical center of gravity calculation at school, you can do the same calculation for where the economic center of gravity of the world was. And if you were to go back 2,000 years, the economic center of gravity of the world was on the India-China border, because India and China were around 35-40% of the global economy each, and it was on the center. And then we saw the Industrial Revolution, and basically, I mean, before the Industrial Revolution, economic center of gravity hardly moved. And then the Industrial Revolution in Europe moved it up towards Europe, and then it moved to the mid-Atlantic. And then since the Second World War, we see it moving back. The economic center of gravity is now moving faster than we've ever seen. Somewhere, it's in North Russia at the moment. And as we see China, India urbanizing, and Africa coming in, the economic center of gravity is going to start moving down this way. And our current forecast is that by 2030 or so, the global economic center of gravity, i.e. the center of where the economic activity of the world is, will actually be here in Astana. So the world's center of economic activity is moving back this way, and we're going to be right at the center of it. And as part of that, we are seeing three major transitions. We're seeing a transition from global growth being in the developed world to three-quarters of global growth being in the developing world. This is a big transition. We're going to see the transition from the US being the largest economy to China. And we're going to see a third transition in the Middle East. We're going to see the transition, we're very likely to see the transition, of Saudi Arabia being the largest economy in the Middle East to Iran. Now, three big transitions happening at the same time. The last time we've seen a transition like that was the transition from the UK being the largest economic power to the US. That happened somewhere between 1870 and 1930, depending on whether you include the British Empire or not. That was a difficult transition, and it was a very turbulent transition, and there are some people who argue the reason that the Depression was so bad was that the US hadn't yet stepped up into the leadership role that they were expected to play as the largest economy. So we're going to be seeing those three transitions. That's going to cause a huge amount of turbulence, but it's going to be a real opportunity too for Kazakhstan. And I'll come back to that in a sec. The final sort of thought in terms of the global economy is for the last 200 years, we've lived in a world where people are better off or the same generally than their parents. People generally have grown up richer or the same in terms of economic power as their parents. So there are a few disruptions, the war, except for the two world wars, but generally the case is that we've been in a world where that transition has resulted in people growing up better off. That is coming to an end. If we look over the last 10 years, and this is driven by the financial crisis, 70 to 80% of people in emerging in developed world are actually worse off than people like them 10 years before. 70% of people. Now that's going to result in a huge challenge, because when you ask people how they think about the world, if you're worse off than the previous generation, you have a very different attitude to the world. You have a different attitude to political systems. You have a very different attitude to free trade, to migration, to traditional political parties. Why have we seen the rise of Alternative for Germany, a Le Pen, UKIP, Donald Trump? It's because there is a cohort who no longer believes the system is resulting in them being worse, better off. And that instability feeds through, and that's going to be, I think, a major challenge for us globally for the next 30 years. So this is a slightly challenging world we're talking about. The transitions, shifting center of gravity, a cohort growing up poorer than their parents. And in that world, I think actually, you know, there are challenges, but I think Kazakhstan has some advantages. You shouldn't write off commodities. It's very easy to be incredibly bullish on commodities 4 years ago, in the same way as it's very easy to be bearish on commodities now. People ask me about the forecast, my forecast for oil price. I typically say I'm in the Goldman Sachs range, because remember, Goldman Sachs had $200 4 years ago and $20 6 months ago. So, you know, I'm somewhere in that range. Commodities will remain important, and Kazakhstan has some really important commodities. And the bit that I think I'm most excited about is the potential for the uranium business here. If you think about it, as we go to a world where climate change matters, nuclear is going to have to become a much more important thing. There's a limit to how much you can rely on wind and solar. You know, you need energy at night. Storage is difficult. You need energy when the wind's not blowing. Nuclear is actually a very viable option, and I think Kazakhstan could be much more creative on the whole uranium game. Not just selling uranium, but also taking it back and treating it and eventually storing it afterwards. This could become a sort of, you know, a different model where Kazakhstan, you know, gets paid for the uranium on the basis of the energy produced, but then takes it back afterwards. So I think there's an opportunity on that. I think the second opportunity for the country is back to the historic strength in Kazakhstan had in the Soviet Union. This was the breadbasket of the Soviet Union. The food industry is a lot less sexy in terms of my, you know, conversations with a lot of investors than the whole commodities industry. But actually, as we think about structural advantage long term, food has a lot more advantage than commodities. Because as people get richer, they're going to require much more land-intensive food. They're going to eat more meat. They're going to eat you know, more vegetables and things that require a lot more land. At the same time as we're getting rid of a lot of land, and climate change is going to result in a lot of land around the world no longer being viable. So this is a huge opportunity for the country to play into that. And the final thought is around, you know, the Silk Route. We heard a little bit about this. If you are, as China moves further west, the logistics of getting stuff that's manufactured in China to the rest of the world starts becoming quite problematic. You know, the ports are pretty clogged, the railways are clogged as you move to the east. The ability to put stuff on a train and take it straight to Europe, it's faster and it could become more effective. And that again will play to strengths of Kazakhstan. So we're in a turbulent world. The turbulence of poor and their parents, shifting economic power, transitions is going to be a problem. But a lot of actually the strengths that Kazakhstan has through the location, through the land, through the ability to play in the commodity, in the food commodity and other general commodity game, actually could play well to Kazakhstan. And I think this is an opportunity for the country. And as I look at other countries around the world, I'm pretty excited about here in comparison to some of the challenges other countries face.
So, Richard, you mentioned some of the instability happening and the rise of populism in Europe and, yeah, and in North America. Something, of course, that has been attractive for investment in Kazakhstan over the last couple of decades has been the political stability.
Yeah.
So it has been a very stable place. That now is starting to shift. So we have the rise of social media and some of those kind of public, yeah, concerns that maybe didn't have a route to voice before now do. We also have an untested political transition in terms of the presidency. Do you think those are issues that investors should worry about?
So, you know, political stability is a challenge across the world. You know, but I think it's very easy to point to the challenge of countries like Kazakhstan or China and say, you know, it's much harder for those countries. Actually, it's not completely clear to me that the advantage is that the disadvantage isn't actually with the classic Western democracies. Let me give you an example. Now, a typical politician will all point to Angela Merkel as the leader in Europe and say, isn't it wonderful? You know, she's running Germany, and you know, obviously there have been a bit of turbulence, but she's still, by many counts, the political leader everyone points to. And they point to the German reforms that happened, and that resulted in Germany's competitiveness. The real issue, though, is that those reforms were not done by Angela Merkel. They were done by her predecessor, who failed to get re-elected and lost in the election to Angela Merkel. I think the Juncker problem is we all know what we need to do, we just don't know how to do it and get re-elected. It is an acute problem. I talk to politicians and leaders in Europe and the US, and their time frame is very short term. I come here, and I go to China, and I talk to people, and they have a 50-year view. So I'm not sure that I would necessarily take a view that somehow there's some magical view in the West. This is a country where people are thinking long term. Yes, there's a need to get the transition, but there's a part of this is understanding for the long term and building the ability to deliver economic growth. And the thing is, economic growth is so important because without the economic growth, you get a cohort that's poorer. The challenge that Western democracies are going to face is this lower economic growth will result in this cohort, and that's going to be the political tensions. If you have the right policies, a country like Kazakhstan actually could ensure that everyone is better off. And that's something that I think that other countries could envy.
Quite an optimistic ground you're setting out for yourself there. Hans, if we can move over to some of your thoughts. I know that you're particularly concerned about the transition from oil, and that you think this is a bit of a larger issue than some people suspect.
Yeah, first of all, thanks for having me here. It's wonderful to be in Kazakhstan. Prime Minister Masimov said in his opening speech that Kazakhstan is flexible. I think it's worth repeating the importance of that notion throughout the day. I agree with Richard that the world economy, not just the oil-producing countries, the world economy is going through dramatic changes, and the countries that will be successful coming out of this period are not the countries that have the best policies, but are the countries that are willing to change and are willing to adjust. And the big problem is that there are still countries, governments, parts of the economies that find it very hard to change and that actually try to look back to times that are gone, cannot be repeated, and the drivers of growth of the past, they will not come back. And I think that has a lot to do with the social unrest that we see all over the world. It's not just the new generations that are poorer than their parents, but it is the fact that in those countries that are backward looking in a time that everything is changing, people have no perspective anymore. There's only nostalgia, there's trying to achieve something which is unachievable, and there's no leadership to start embracing the new opportunities that are out there. And that's why, especially in young generations, you see a lot of anxiety. Labor markets all over the world are changing. It's very difficult to have a steady job and be part of a big company. The technologies are changing. If the government is not embracing that development and making sure that there is a new social contract that is consistent with that new development, but we stick with the policies that were there for the past, and you have a problem. Richard went back into history. Let me try to do that also, but not going as far back as Richard did. Because for me, one of the trends at the moment is what everybody calls the new normal. The new normal after 2008, 2009, a big crisis, and whatever countries are doing, you're not getting the growth rates what you had in that decade before. That is not a unique episode. That happened before. And you can go back 40 years, There was a boom during the 1960s, very high growth in the high-income countries, the end of the Reconstruction in Europe. You had very high growth in Latin America through import substitution. And then the oil crisis hit, and that was another trigger. And in the 70s and the 80s, it was very difficult to get these high growth pattern again. And that created a lot of anxiety also. If you go, I don't know whether that's a regularity, but if you go back yet another 40 years, then you're not in the 60s, but you're in the roaring 20s. Also a period of very high growth. Almost whatever you did was successful. There was a lot of wealth created, a lot of financial wealth was created, and we all know that ended up in the Great Depression. And I think it's in those terms that we should cast the current challenges. We are in a period where all countries will have to find new sources of growth. Something that Japan had to do in the 80s was not successful because it had to open up the service sector. It didn't do that. Now, on top of that, in an oil-producing country or countries surrounding the oil-producing countries, you have that additional shock of a lower oil price, which I tend to think of as part of really a very long super cycle. So it is a new normal also. And people forget how big that shock is. Last year, Kazakhstan lost more than 10% of its income. That's a larger decline than countries experienced in 2009, and that was very, very difficult to absorb. And it requires enormous adjustments. It requires rethinking of monetary policy. And we have seen an important part of that, but not everything of that. Then you have to address the vulnerabilities that are being created in the financial sector. Because of dollarization, the depreciation, but also because all kinds of relative prices are changing now. You should expect the prices of real estate, especially the non-residential real estate, to drop dramatically. You have then the fiscal problems that have to be addressed, and then that very important point, you have to be very clear that the burden sharing is fair. More than 10% decline of your income, so who is experiencing that decline? And ultimately, you have to absorb those shocks by looking forward and by seizing these new opportunities that are being created, either by new technologies that are coming in a new normal, or by the fact that now suddenly Kazakhstan is a lot more competitive in non-oil tradable sectors than it used to be. And so the task is now to be relentless about creating jobs. Whatever impedes creating jobs in the non-tradable sector should be the focus. And what I heard already this morning, that forward-looking approach, that's incredibly important. And that's, I think, where Kazakhstan could have an advantage.
One of these big structural shifts that's happening is China's economic transition. One of the problems in China at the moment is this huge industrial overcapacity they've got. And of course, that's one reason why China is implementing the One Belt, One Road strategy. It's thinking Central and South Asia and East Africa are places it can go and dump all of its excess industrial capacity. All of its excess steel can be used up over here and solve some of the problems in China's industrial sector. Is there some kind of conflict between what China's objectives are in the One Belt, One Road, and what a country like Kazakhstan would like to achieve through industrialization?
First of all, I don't see it merely as a problem of overcapacity in China. That sounds almost as if we are looking at a cyclical downturn in the world, and then we have a problem of overcapacity. I think what we are experiencing in China is something that is happening on the supply side. It's one of those transformations that we see in other parts of the world also. Like Japan in the 1960s, when it started reaching more the technological frontier in manufacturing, it became more and more difficult to increase productivity year after year and to maintain incredibly competitive all over the world. That's a mechanism that you're seeing in China now also. The resource that they had of a very very cheap, low-skilled labor coming from rural areas, that is drying up at the moment. You see enormous wage pressures, and China is no longer that competitive. Now, some firms will experience that and will find it difficult to use their full capacity. But that is not because of demand. I think it's because of what's happening on the supply side. And China is a very good example of a country with a government that actually is willing to change. There are dramatic examples of their willingness to change and forward-looking. And so China is trying to move away from the manufacturing sector, to move away from the heavy industry, to move away from investments in infrastructure, which moved up to 50% of the economy, and trying to develop a service sector. Mm-hmm. Now, when you look at it this way, it is a change, an adjustment on the supply side. I think then there are opportunities and there are challenges for Kazakhstan and other surrounding countries. There's a challenge because if China is no longer growing that fast, then that's another blow to commodity prices. It's not the main reason why commodity prices are so low at the moment, but it doesn't help, obviously, in the recovery. But there's actually an opportunity, because if Chinese industry is becoming less competitive, then there's an opportunity for industry in other countries. And when we looked at the bilateral real exchange rate of individual countries vis-a-vis China last year, then the one that depreciated most was actually Kazakhstan. It was a 50% depreciation, which means that suddenly you are half as expensive than Chinese competitors. And you discussed earlier in the earlier session the problems of the logistics, a big country, few people, and it's very costly, but you don't have to export all the time to become successful in a tradable sector. One thing is that you become more competitive to importers that are already in your country. And so we did very recently a study of all those changes in China on this part of the region, and our conclusion was that on average it was slightly positive. There are as many opportunities as there are challenges.
Okay, I'm going to bring Richard in on China too, but just after this, we will come out to the audience for questions. If there's anything you'd like to ask Richard or Hans, please do start thinking about it and build up your confidence to be that first person to raise your hand. I know it's very scary, but I'm hoping someone is going to be ready to go first. Richard.
I think the the real drive to the One Belt, One Road policy in China isn't about getting rid of the excess capacity. I mean, actually, when you look at most of the excess capacity and where it is, it still will go globally through ships because it's coastal capacity in many cases. Not completely, but it's very... I think it's driven by two things. First of all, this is driven by China trying to work out one mechanism of stepping up and becoming the number one economic power in the world. And for them to be the economic power in the world is you have to have better relationships with your neighbors and you have to have economic connections with your neighbors. And by connecting through here to Europe eventually, and to the Middle East and to places like Iran and all of Central Asia, is it's part of that. So I think that's one of the drivers of that. I think the second driver is just the sheer logistics. If you look at China, where the next wave of urbanization is happening, is it the coasts are maxed out. It's going to happen further west in the country. The country has to get more activity happening there. And the problem is when you get activity there, if you start moving manufacturing more into the central China, is it becomes very hard to work out the route to market. Because trying to put it onto trains and trying to put it onto through the traditional ports. So actually it's a natural thing to sort of say, well, let's go directly to Europe and to other countries, like Iran, through that. So I think that those are really what's driving it. This isn't as much a dumping. I mean, other parts of the world are being impacted by the dumping.
Right, okay. Yeah. Hans, you want to come back?
Yeah, I think there's another reason related why China is investing so much in this region. I worked with the Chinese government some 4 years ago on the China 2030 study. And it was impressive how willing China was to dramatically change policies. And the reason was that they realized that what was successful in the past is not a guarantee in the future. And if you really want to become a high-income country, you have to change your policies. One of those changes that was discussed was the shift from inward FDI towards outward FDI. So for decades, China had benefited from inviting companies in the country. It got access to technologies, it got access to the world market, and in the process, it created more competition in the Chinese economy. And they realized that when they move up the development ladder and when they want to become a high-income country, then that same mechanism, the same objectives, will be realized through a very different mechanism. That's outward FDI. Basically, internationalization of the Chinese companies. That's another way of getting access to technology. It's another way of entering the world market. And it's something that all countries have done because it's almost the only way of moving up the value chain. And so when we were doing that study some 4 years ago, outward FDI was almost zero. And now 4 years later, outward FDI is larger than inward FDI. I think it's all a very natural process that is consistent with the change in the Chinese economy that we are observing. And it's one of the things where Kazakhstan and this region can benefit from a lot, I think. And part of it is the Silk Road, but there are other initiatives also. You can really benefit from the change in the Chinese economy.
Just pausing for a moment to give...
Newmont Mining Company, America's largest gold producer. Well, thanks for your comments, gentlemen. Both of you have expressed considerable optimism about Kazakhstan's prospects. Very impressive. You've also mentioned there are challenges. Could you share with us your views of what the three or four major challenges are now for Kazakhstan that they must overcome to attract significantly more Western investment, and what are the prospects for overcoming those challenges in the next few years?
Could I get you to answer your own question first? So, as a potential investor, I mean, what are some of the things that worry you?
Well, we're looking at a number of issues. There are questions of in our sector. A new mining law that is pending, but it's very difficult to find out what the contents of the draft law are now, so that creates a lot of uncertainty. But beyond that, it's useful to hear your thoughts on how you expect national leadership to evolve in the coming years. As well. And my main concern about that is the influence, will the influence of the national government continue to be as strong as it is now, or are we likely to see more independence on the part of local governments that may be very difficult for foreign companies to deal with?
Yeah. Okay. Yes. Hans, do you want to start?
Yeah, thanks a lot. Let me mention three challenges. One is the implementation of the reforms, because we see many, many reforms, and that is actually very, very impressive. We see big improvements in the doing business indicator that we monitor in the World Bank, but in practice, that's never enough. In practice, reality is always tougher than what is written in these reforms. So a big challenge is to create an environment where complaints are immediately taken seriously, where impediments that are still there, despite all the good reforms that we're seeing, are taken seriously. So the practicality of reforms, that's difficult in every single country, it will be difficult in Kazakhstan also. A second one is, I think, the challenge to create a really vibrant, competitive private sector that can compete in international markets in the tradable sector. So that is not just a couple of successful big projects where Kazakhstan can make a big leap forward in certain sectors, but to have that change in the economy that is needed, to have that become successful, it has to be really broad-based, which means also lots of small and medium-sized enterprises that can not only enter the market, but can survive and can thrive, and to create a very vibrant economy. And that's also something that is not easy in other countries. Also, it will not be easy here. And the third one, I think, is about social cohesion. It's about making sure that this big shock that is incredibly tough, and we underestimate how tough it is to absorb a shock like this, that the burden is shared fairly, and it's very transparent who's taking the burden. And I think, again, it's not just a challenge for Kazakhstan. We have discussed already political development in the United States and in other places. But when you have these big transitions, it is incredibly difficult to navigate that also on the social side. So that would be my three challenges.
Yeah.
I have three very similar ones. The first challenge is the size of the state here. And I have to admit, I mean, I was part of the creation of Samruk in 2005. The mission at that point was a small Samruk, lots more privatization. And, you know, a series of crises have come along that have resulted in, you know, for very compelling reasons, more Samruk, more government holding companies. But, you know, the challenge is the scale of government-owned sector, of government-owned companies, and the role of the state is going to get in the way. And so I think that part of the challenge is going to be getting the privatization program, using the current crisis to really push through some privatization, and getting a much smaller state sector. There are certain things that have to remain state-owned for national reasons, but, you know, to get a smaller state sector and to get that through and to get people comfortable with that is going to be a challenge. And I think that, you know, that we're excited by the privatization program. We're slightly depressed a little bit on the speed at which it's going in terms of that. You know, I think it's been very compelling why Samruk has expanded scope of Samruk over the last few years because of the crisis, because of the current crisis with the collapse of the ruble and the collapse of the commodity sector. But I think, you know, continuing the momentum of trying to get a smaller state and not allowing this to continue creeping up, I think is the first one. The second one is, you know, there is still a very, you know, Soviet approach to some things in government. It may seem a silly thing. Anyone who's visited a government building and met the security guard, and the security guard will have a series of memos on their desk with everyone who's meant to be coming to that building with their passport numbers written there. And he'll scroll through finding the meeting you're meant to be going to and finding this. I mean, you know, this is a world where really the security guard might have this on a computer system. And I mean, Western, other countries had computer systems there. And that is a little bit about the way that sort of some of the aspects of governments work, is it's very much these memos and that type of thing. You know, what would it take to evolve to a something that is a bit more? And then I think that the final one is just the challenge of getting reforms through. And as Hans mentioned, you know, this is not just a Kazakhstan issue. This is an issue on many parts of the world. Reforms are difficult to get through. And we saw here, you know, land reforms are really important. You know, the one commodity sector that I think has been underplayed here but has a greater source of advantage, as I mentioned earlier, is the whole food sector. But to get the food sector, you've got to get, you know, land reforms. So you've also got to get the logistics, you've got to get the processing, you've got to get all of that right as well. But, you know, getting land reforms through is difficult. You know, in the same way as getting the size of the state sectors down is going to be hard. So dealing with a lot of these challenges, and I think that's going to involve political leadership. It's also going to involve getting growth to happen. If you have a rising tide and everyone is better off, it is much easier to do things like land reforms. If some people are getting worse off because the economy is growing less, it's much harder to do that. So I think the challenge of getting reforms to happen and pushing those through, I think, is the third challenge. So, you know, it's how you deal with getting the state smaller, how you evolve the mode of operation of government to be more modern, less traditional sort of memos or whatever, and finally how you deal with some of these tough reforms and get them through.
Yeah, I think agriculture is an interesting story, and we do have a roundtable, I think, with the Vice Minister this afternoon on agriculture. Certainly from an anecdotal kind of level, when you fly into Kazakhstan, I mean, the kind of vibrancy of the spring growth, you can certainly see how it does have the geographic potential to be a big market. And productivity here in the agricultural sector, I think, is only around 10% that in some of the highest productivity countries.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. But I mean, you know, that to get some of that productivity, you have to address the land reform. And I know these things are hard. I'm not saying that, you know, it wasn't, you know, the slowing of the reforms, you know, I understand why it's difficult to get momentum behind some of these things. But that is the challenge, because without that type of reforms, without the supply chain, you're not going to get the huge benefit of making this sort of breadbasket 2.0, or whatever you like to think of it.
Yeah. How do you want to come back?
Yeah, obviously, when you look at the size of the country, there's an enormous potential there, and which can go way beyond just agriculture, but the agro-business and then the food processing is very important. At the same time, I learned something from Richard this morning. I always thought that Ukraine was the breadbasket of the Soviet Union, but apparently... it would not be strange, because Kazakhstan definitely has that potential.
And I mean, this session we're aiming to focus on sort of some big global trends that will affect Kazakhstan. But to come back to the audience for hopefully the next question, of course, this is one of them is the rise of the middle class in emerging markets, which we were all super excited about 3 years ago. People have sort of forgotten about, but actually medium term, that story is still there, and growing quality
and the potential of tourism because of that.
Anyway, we can keep talking.
My question is about your views on the outlook for Russia and the extent to which this might be a concern for Kazakhstan's growth in the coming 5-10 years.
Well, I'm an optimist on the Russian geographic expansion push. You know, there are obviously some people who believe that we've only seen the start of it, but I think the pain that I think Russia has felt, partially driven by, you know, the sanctions, partially driven by other stuff, means that we're not going to be seeing any more of that. Obviously, if that were not the case, that is a huge worry for Kazakhstan. And, you know, you can certainly, any of you coming here during the whole Crimea thing, saw the anxiety going up. So that's the first aspect of the Russia one. I think the more important part of the Russia thing is actually the impact that the ruble collapse has done on competitors. You know, you mentioned, Hans, the 50% collapse of the or drop off in the tenge, but I think the real challenge is the ruble has gone even further down. And so the competitiveness of Russian companies being able to sell into Kazakhstan, or Kazakhstan companies being able to sell into Russia as an export market is I think quite problematic. Now, again, my sense is that enough people around the world want Russia back at the table. And if I were to bet on this, we're gonna see Russia back, sanctions off, within the next year. It'll be a deal around Syria. Russia will broker the deal in Syria, and as a result, Russia will be back. So I'm optimistic that we're going to see that path back, and I think there's enough concern in Russia that you don't want to go further. Because, you know, I mean, we talk about sanctions. We haven't done real sanctions. Talk to the Iranians about what it's like to feel sanctions. You know, not accessing SWIFT is a huge issue. Know, anyone who's trying to take money in and out of Iran at the moment, not being able to use SWIFT and not being able to have the banking system do that. You know, if we really wanted to do real sanctions on Russia, we would have done, you know, SWIFT or other stuff like that. So I think that there is a sense that we've got to find an answer on both sides. And so I'm optimistic that we're going to see some pretty interesting movements sometime later this year on that.
Yeah. Further questions from the audience, so we can come back.
World Bank view of Russia.
Yeah.
The World Bank view on Russia is a very economic view, and I think it is one of the additional problems that Kazakhstan is facing. Yeah. The fact that also Russia was hit by the lower oil prices. And I think the ruble fall is exactly consistent with that fall in oil prices. We have these models at the World Bank, and you don't need any other explanation. It's a perfect fit. And the Russian macroeconomic response to the fall in oil prices was also well done. But that doesn't change the fact that also Russia lost a lot of income. And that means that the potential of the Eurasian Economic Union that was there is now no longer that strong. And that means that the policy of Kazakhstan to be more independent and to try to connect to other major powers also is ultimately one that can save Kazakhstan. And from that perspective, the focus on the connectivity makes a lot more sense, because it's just a difficult environment. You can't rely just for economic terms on the Eurasian Economic Union anymore.
Yeah. I mean, it's not part of any of the big mega regionals. Many of its main trading partners are. Is it going to be isolated?
No, I would argue no. No, I think there's lots of interest from different economic centers in the world of actually cooperating with Kazakhstan to improve that connectivity. And ultimately, that means then also to solve the trade barriers in Kazakhstan. I'm not a pessimist there.
Okay. All right. Thanks very much, Richard and Hans. Yeah.